Day. Today's discussion will be on rational choice theory. If you remember from our first lecture, we already introduced rational choice theory. We said that rational choice theory has gained prominence in the latter decades of the 20th century. You may be familiar with this as it derives its major assumptions from economics, saying that individuals are rationally self-interested and would choose whatever benefits them. This could be used in political analysis, not just in the level of individuals, but also in the level of states. Unlike behavioralism, it uses observation for its study to validate its theory about the individual. Unlike behavioralism, that observes before it theorizes, RCT theorizes before observing, assuming that rational action will always be the outcome of decision-making of an individual. We will now discuss this approach further. Rational choice theory is an approach in understanding political phenomena. As an economic theory of politics, it derives majority of its core assumptions in economic theory. In fact, this theory was developed by some economists and political scientists in the United States in the 1960s. It can also be traced to the realist tradition in international relations, where scholars assume and understand states' actions as mere self-interest. Like, for example, if a state ratifies the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, this does not mean that the state and its leaders are committed to it and its provisions, but because they see that it is in their advantage to ratify the declaration. As you can see, this is a more pessimistic view of state action, assuming that they only act based on self-interest. As I have mentioned, RCT derives many of its assumptions from economics. Political scientists who use the approach also deliberately use the methods of economics in their study. This includes the ideas of rationality, self-interest or interest, cost, utility maximization, public choice, free riding behavior, and collective action. We'll try to discuss this one by one. These are the key assumptions of rational choice theory that we will be discussing for this lecture. First is that, for rational choice theorists, individual actors are the basic units of analysis. Second, these individuals are rational, efficient, and instrumental utility maximizers who seek to maximize personal utility net of cost alone. Lastly, individuals have a clear and transitive hierarchy of preferences such that, in any given context, there is only one optimal course of action available to them. So the first concept we need to understand is individual. For rational choice theory, the individual is the basic unit of analysis. The basic idea of rational choice theorists is that essentially individuals by themselves are rational. This means that when we choose the things we do, we make rational decisions. We calculate the cost and benefit and then decide on what's best for us. However, when you aggregate these individual rational decisions, this leads to irrational outcomes. For example, we may choose to buy our drinks in plastic cups and straws like this because for us, either milk tea or iced coffee or tea is a good refreshment. However, if many of us drink in plastic cups and use straws, those individual choices lead to irrational outcomes, like straws and plastic trash going to oceans and endangering the health of animals living there. Even though it was rational for us to use the plastic for our own needs at the time, because we thought that it was no additional cost to us, it has actually some adverse effects if we aggregate those individual choices. We can define this approach thus as an approach to politics based on the assumption that individuals are rationally self-interested actors. What is important in this definition are the two core ideas that are particular to rational choice theory and economics. One is rationality, and second is self-interest. Rational choice theorists assume that people can be relied upon in ways which best secure their goals, and these goals reflect their self-interest. As with the example from the realist tradition in international relations, rational choice theorists assume that people act because of self-interest. So in the said example, we said that we choose to drink milk tea or iced coffee in plastic cups and straws because we think that it's a refreshing drink and that it's really no additional cost to us to have milk tea or iced coffee in those containers. This is rationality in action. This is when we think of a course of action and thinking about the benefits and costs. We have preferences, like for example, what flavor of milk tea or sinkers to put in it. Our choices are then decided upon after this process. We think about the best choice based on the benefit or incentives and cost of that choice to us. Individuals aim to achieve maximum personal utility. This means a course of action or a thing should have the least cost and the most benefit to us. So in that process, we can discern ideas of self-interest and our reckoning of incentives. In economics, for example, economists bank on the people's self-interests for a market to function. That is, the self-interest of the consumer to buy and the self-interest of the producer or firm to sell. In this situation, what must be understood is the context of self-interest. This could be seen through looking at people's incentive structures in order to explain their actions. If people have an incentive to do an action, like for example, in buying, they are able to reap the benefits from the product that they bought, in selling, they earn profit, they are more likely to do it. Furthermore, economists argue that people make choices because of incentives and self-interest. Making a choice also means that people rationalize their actions or options and choices to be able to maximize their utility. For example, if one is to buy a laptop, one would, in a normal market setting, aim to know the specifications of the laptop that he or she or they could buy based on his or her or their budget, and his or her or their purpose for buying the laptop. Consistent to rational choice, one would then buy the laptop that is within their budget and fit for their needs. Thus, the action of buying the laptop can be said to be rational and based on self-interest. This is what was applied by political scientists in non-market settings. We can ask ourselves, why do people vote? Why does the government favor the anti-terrorism bill or law more than, for instance, a bill or law for mass testing? What are the incentives that could explain the actions of people and the government? Given these, it is apparent that rational choice theory assumes that people's behavior are predictable. If everybody is rational, then you can infer what their choices would be given the set of options and situation. Like behavioralism, rational choice theorists also put premium on empirical testing. Furthermore, they take pride in the ability of the theory to predict real-world actions and decisions. Hindmore, 2010, discusses party competition as an example of rational choice theory in action. The behavior of political parties in liberal democracies is predictable given the structure of the electoral system and the distribution of voter preferences. In this context, rational choice theorists argue that parties, take note that this is in the context of more mature democracies where there is supposedly a clear line between and among parties' platforms and agenda. So these parties tend to be pure vote maximizers. The Downs perspective explains this tendency of parties, politicians, and leaders. This perspective posits that leaders or politicians would be more likely to make or propose policies in order to win elections and not purely because of their party alignment. According to this view, the differences in party could also mean differences in people who prefer one policy position than the other party. For example, it is assumed that Democrats would favor a universal healthcare program more than Republicans or conservatives. If one is a Democrat, it is assumed that he or she or they will vote for a Democrat in office. In the real world, however, this does not happen as smoothly as this. Therefore, the Downs perspective argues that both parties, instead of just catering to their party members, who will sure vote for them, they won't be catering to just their party members. They will be catering to what is called the median voter. This median voter is not inclined to prefer the policy of a universal healthcare, or the left, or the policy preferred by the left, or no healthcare service, which is preferred by the right. Those in the middle may prefer a policy that incorporates the Democrats and the Republicans' view on healthcare. Downs argue that the two parties would then converge to the center to address the views of the median voter. If a party gets most of its median of the median voter's vote, then there is incentive to tweaking their policy position more to the center. This is illustrated in the diagram here. So Hindmore, the reading for this part of the course, recognizes that this seems pretty simple. A normal person could probably opine or think that the Democrats must make their policy position more friendly to the average voter Z, or the average voter, in order to get more votes. Rational choice theory, however, adds value to such arguments by identifying the precise circumstances under which parties converge upon the center ground, and by telling us what might happen when these circumstances are not met. Owing to the power of prediction of the theory, it could explain the decisions of the party to tweak their policy position for the voters. It must be noted, however, that correlation does not mean causation, and it must be recognized that the move to the center can also be caused by other factors. So there are other videos that could help you understand the median voter, so they are posted in our course site. So a rational choice model of voting is also discussed in Haywood, so you could also read that. You could also check out videos on other theories related to rational choice theory, such as the prisoner's dilemma and game theory, to better understand this approach in political analysis. There are several problems where we can apply the basic or key ideas of rational choice theory. First is the free rider problem. We discuss self-interest, right? This problem notes the possible outcomes of selfish decisions or choices made by individuals, especially when aggregated. According to this, social welfare is often compromised by collective action problems and free riding. This problem refers to the tendency to individual selfishness such that an individual who stands to benefit anyway from a common good does not contribute to its attainment by joining in collective action. For example, if there is a consensus in our community that we will protect the environment or we need to protect the environment, or at least there is enough information going around that we need to take action and take care of the environment, it is the reality that not everyone will comply, especially if it's not in law form. They will think that even though they do not protect the environment, for example, through not buying cars and taking public transportation or riding bicycles instead, other people will do it for them. Regardless of one's contribution or non-contribution, they will then get the incentive of a good and clean environment or surroundings. This is because they rationalize that there's actually no disincentive or punishment for choosing to help in this endeavor. Collective action then fails. What the free rider problem actually reinforces is the key idea of rational choice theory, that people act based on their perceived incentives and disincentives. Another example is voting. Some people vote because they think it's something that is good. Some people do not vote because they think it's a waste of their time, something that others will vote for who is good anyway. A low voter turnout, however, proves the failure of a collective action, as the undeserving candidates are voted in office because many people did not participate in the decision-making. To counter this, voting participation can be encouraged through easier registration. Like, for example, recently there has been this proposal for precincts, voting precincts, to be in malls, and disincentives for politicians who cheat in elections. So citizen organizations could also help through public assistance desks and voter education meetings. So what this tells us is that people are calculating whether something that they will do has a cost to them, or will this thing that they will do will have incentives or disincentives for them. So public choice theory is another application of rational choice theory. This theory notes that the narrow pursuit of self-interest ensures that public officials cannot be trusted to deliver collective welfare. If we assume that every one of us is calculating and that we are acting based on our self-interest, then we can assume the same for politicians. With this, it can be said that politicians are vulnerable to strong lobbies, meaning that their decisions as well as their proposed policies can be influenced. For example, in a city where tourism is the main source of income for people, a mayor can be influenced to open the borders of the city to tourists despite the threat of COVID-19, to cater to either small or big businesses that get their income from tourists. The worst case scenario is that politicians will be blinded by money and enforce policies that benefit only a select few. These lead to some government failures. So what that example from the other slide also shows is the possibility of rent seeking in the government. Rent seeking is the act of obtaining special treatment by the government at the expense of the general public. In your readings for this week, you're asked to read on the case of the Lopezes in the Philippines, where they became successful businessmen because they knew the value of connections, especially the relationship to the presidency. So as you can see, this article does not talk about present Lopezes, the ones who are the owners of ABS-CBN, but because it seems that they are hated by the present administration. But there was a time that they were favored by the president, and this is the way that they amassed considerable wealth, and the way that they could have expanded their business from media to other business ventures. So rent in this context could be in the form of the government allowing only one company to have a monopoly on certain sectors like transportation or the exportation of some products. This means that the government will bar other companies to enter the market through policies and regulations. So you would ask, why would the government allow such a thing? Because there would be incentives for them. So rational choice theory, incentives. In the case of Quezon during his time, Lopez was able to give him assurance of votes for his and his allies' election. A related term to this is patron-client relations. This means the exchange of favors from two camps. In the case mentioned, Quezon provides the monopoly to the market, to the Lopezes, while the Lopezes provide him with votes and other political machinery like good articles in their newspaper. So I want you to read the case further and see the process of rent-seeking in previous administrations in the Philippines. So use this for your debate in our VLE. So we now move to some of the representative works for rational choice theory. So first we have Downs, Anthony Downs, through his work Economic Theory of Democracy. We have discussed him previously through the median voter. Another idea from him is that voting is irrational. According to him, there is little incentive for the well-informed voter as he has virtually no chance to determine the outcome of the election. So spending time following the issues is not personally worthwhile for the voter. Again, this would come as a result of the assumption that voters are utility maximizers. If there is no incentive to vote, then they would not be inclined to vote. Or if there is no incentive to know more about the candidates that you are voting, then they would not do so and they would just vote. So even if you inform yourself of all the information about the candidates and their platform, as mentioned, candidates tweak their position based on public opinion. So this is no guarantee that who you will vote for will implement the policy that is best for everyone, or the policy that made the policy or platform that made you vote for him or her. Another is Garrett Hardin in his work Tragedy of the Commons and related works. So Hardin, in his idea of the tragedy of the commons, presents a dilemma for people and collective action. The idea of the spaceship Earth notes that we only have one Earth and that we all should cooperate for it to persist and so we could enjoy its resources more. Hardin notes that the Earth's resources is finite and no, we're not in a spaceship Earth. So he's actually responding against the idea of a spaceship Earth. We're actually in a lifeboat where not everyone could board. If the Earth is considered a spaceship where everyone could share the resources, then this will lead to a tragedy of the commons. The lifeboat scenario goes as follows. So you imagine with a lifeboat with 50 people on board. This lifeboat has a capacity of 60 people, and in the ocean outside, there swim the poor of the world who would like to get in. So those 50 people in the lifeboat, you can consider them the rich countries already seated in the lifeboat, and the people swimming are the poor trying to get in. So according to him, the limit of the lifeboat, which is 60 people, denotes the carrying capacity of the lifeboat. So if you seat or board like 70 people, it will sink. So according to him, this should not be exceeded for the survival of the people on board. So you know what that entails or what that implies, right? He's saying that rich people are only the ones who need to be in the lifeboat, and that we should not let poor people, because the boat will sink. So if you, yeah, he said that only Western countries could actually fit in the lifeboat, and that it has no space anymore for poor countries. In his work, he actually says that the 10, because there are only 50 people, right? The 10 extra seats are for protection of those 50 people, or, you know, 50 or countries in the lifeboat. If you translate this to resources, it says that the resources of the Earth right now is finite, okay? And those people in the lifeboat, only them have the rights and access to it. Those poor people or poor countries who do not have resources would not also have rights to the resources of the Earth. Because if you let them in, or if you let them get the resources of the Earth, then the boat will sink. The Earth will die. That's what Garrett Hardin is saying. So since the resources of the Earth is finite, then we should protect it from further environmental destruction. According to him, we should not treat the Earth's resources as a commons or as things that are free for all. According to him, if poor countries, for example, will be given food or some resources from other countries because they do not have enough, or in case of famine, this will make poor countries, or in case of famine, according to him, this will make poor countries dependent on the aid given to them by richer countries. They would also have no incentive to work or provide for themselves. The tragedy comes when rich countries give them aid and they continue to receive aid, exploiting the resources of the Earth. Of course, this dilemma could not just be explained by this one slide. You can search videos regarding this. But it is clear that this position is controversial. As an egoist stance, Hardin is only concerned about his interests and the Western countries, so that they would not have the burden of giving aid or help to other poor countries. By arguing that poor countries do not work hard and it is actually their problem why they have famines and other crises, his argument is twisted, as he argues that in the long run, this scenario will be the best for everyone. So if you search this man, Hardin, okay, you will see that there will be articles saying, telling us about his racism, okay, elitism. Okay. But his work and himself is a testament or an example of rational choice theory, because he's just for his own interest, or for the interest of Western countries, but he's disguising it as interest for all, or for the whole environment. Mankur Olson has also this work called The Logic of Collective Action in 1978. So his idea is related to the idea of the free rider problem that we have previously discussed. According to him, people are selfish as they are rational and self-interested. If there is a common goal to be pursued, people have a tendency to choose themselves and their own self-interest. This is where policy comes in. Unless there is coercion, selective incentives will stimulate a rational individual in a latent group to act in a group-oriented way. If there is no law that would disincentivize free-riding behavior, then they would likely not cooperate. If you think about it, the Philippine government uses this logic to blame Filipinos for the COVID-19 crisis. Even though Filipinos have this culture of crisis, that we have a tendency to just obey, especially when needed. But we cannot generalize though. There are studies on this, however, in other parts of the world. So the Philippine government disincentivize Filipinos for their non-cooperation through arresting those not wearing masks or face shields, labeling them as uncooperative. It's the same with other policies like the smoking ban in public areas. The collective good of clean air and surroundings can only be achieved if people are coerced through law, since they won't act on their own otherwise. So as you can see, this is quite a pessimistic view of humanity. But that's rational choice theory. So another is this work called The Calculus of Consent in 1962. So their work relates to rational choice theory's notion that the collective is irrational. One example of their argument is that they note that majority rule does not necessarily produce desirable collective decisions. So you can consult the lecture notes for the other arguments of Buchanan and Tulloch. So Weimer and Weining, in their work Policy Analysis, Concept and Practice in 1991, also deal with problems of majority rule, noting that democracy does not always lead to the good or best. Like Buchanan and Tulloch, they still argue that democracy is still preferable. Voting could also be manipulated by those who control the agenda, showing their self-interest. Majority rule is also problematic, as the majority could be tyrannical over the minority. This is the cost of this setup. They also argue that policies that are good for everyone do not always become implemented, since we also discussed that this process is also susceptible to the interests of those who do rent-seeking or lobbying. Again, this shows how self-interest and rational choice affects the workings of the state and government. So, they say that policies that would spread large aggregate benefits widely and uniformly may not elicit active political support, because for any individual, the costs of political activity exceed the expected benefits rent-seeking by concentrated interests. So from Allison and Zelikow's work, Essence of Decision, we can actually draw some questions for political analysis. So these questions are from Casambre 2017. So here we can apply rational choice theory, not just in the level of individual. So first, what are the objective or perceived circumstances that the state conceives as threats or opportunities? So the idea of threats and opportunities pertain to costs of some decisions. This is a question in RCT, as for example, we can ask, what is the benefit of the Philippines in being friends with China? What is it in for us? What is in it for us? Duterte at one point noted that this is for China to prioritize the Philippines in the distribution and delivery of vaccines. So you can see, you can search news about that. There was also this question when Duterte decided to pardon Pemberton, a murderer, and deported him to the US, saying that this has something to do with US support to the Philippines, when the US did not ask for him to pardon the murderer. The second question is, what are the state's goals? So goals could also mean potential benefits. Three, what are the objective or perceived options for addressing the issue? Four, what are the objective or perceived strategic costs and benefits of each option? And fifth, what is the state's best choice given these conditions? So best choice is the choice after the rationalization of self-interest and maximum utility. How did the government come up with the choice that they made? So a nuance here is that the decision or a choice may be made for the benefit of a person and not necessarily the people, meaning one person and not the majority or all the constituents. Even though people elect politicians so that they would work for them, the reality is that these officials are still human and are also rational beings. They would do what's best for them, regardless of their mandate. This is how we can tie up the previous arguments on democracy. Democracy lets us vote representatives, supposedly for the good of the majority or the common good, but this does not happen because our collective decision turned out to be irrational. Some also did not participate in the decision-making. In the end, it is the self-interest of those in position that would be the basis for decisions that will affect the whole nation or state. Take note, however, that this is just one approach. So we're not saying that this is true, that it is irrational to vote, but according to to rational choice theory, it is. So while this may hold true at times, there can still be other ways to look at these scenarios. So always remember that we're looking at approaches or ways of looking at political phenomena. So rational choice theory is just one of those approaches. So that is why we should also look at the limitations of this approach. So first, it relies upon a series of implausible theoretical assumptions. The assumption that humans are self-interested and that they know their preferences is not always true. We do not always know what we want. Okay, and then second, rational choice's empirical record is quite poor. As I have mentioned, rational choice theory also puts premium on empirical testing. In actual studies, however, the predictions and the explanations of rational choice theory does not match the results of studies based on empirical observation. So there is also critique to the Downs perspective. It could also be the case that party shapes the minds and interests of their constituents through mobilization of public opinion in order to get their votes. So it's not just the parties considering or taking advantage of the fact that people would be median voters. So it could also be the party that shapes their minds. We could then question if one's self-interest is really their self-interest. So remember the radical view of power, so you could apply it to that critique, the rational choice theory. So on rationality and self-interest, so people are rational to the extent that they select the best possible means to achieve their goals. This means that there could be a limit to people's assumed rationality. So we said a while ago that we do not always know what we want. So it's also true that we do not always know what is the best choice. So there's also the inconsistency with rational choice theory's assumption about humans. They do not recognize that people do not always have perfect information. So take for example the case of a laptop. Okay, say you bought one and found out that there is a better one after buying it. Provided for example that you did not know about that brand before, you could now say that you did not have perfect information before choosing to buy the laptop. So that makes for bad decisions, right? That we do not always have perfect information. So rational choice theory seems to be missing that. Furthermore, people do not always do what is best for them, given the information that they do have. So just look at the Philippines. We know how dangerous it is that we do not have vaccines rolled out yet, So there is scientific information, or there is virtually no basis on the face shield requirement, but we still do it. Okay, so even if you have the best information, it's not always that people will choose that information. So as Hinmore says, we routinely act in suboptimal ways. So in voting, there are also studies pointing to the fact that voters have deep-seated prejudices and are irrational about voting. You cannot always think that people vote for their own interest or for the interest that they think is best. Okay, some have, you know, deep-seated prejudices that they don't know the person who is running for office, or they have some personal feelings against him or her, like that. And lastly, regarding self-interest, where rational choice theory always assumes the worst in people, it's not always the case that people's action can be explained by their self-interest. So some can be explained by justice and fairness and altruism too. There could also be other motivations, for example, for politicians to be elected into office. It's not always money. Okay, so we cannot assume that everyone is the same. So another limitation is rational choice theory does not actually explain the origin of people's self-interest. So where does interest come from? So if you remember, it's also a question in the study of power. It pays insufficient attention to social and historical factors, failing to recognize, amongst other things, that human self-interestedness may be socially conditioned and not merely innate. Because rational choice theory is saying that people are just naturally rational. So This critique says that we need to look at the context. So other critiques are that it has a limited conception of the human subject, it ignores ideas and human agency, and it has limited attention given to the institutional context in which rationality is exercised. So, according to critics, the logic of the explanation is wrong. Rational choice privileges structure over agency and ignores ideas. So structure, let's just say the system, for rational choice theorists, dictate one's actions. So you have no agency. You don't have the will to do anything independently. This is exemplified by the argument that people do things because they want to get incentives. Like, for example, they will vote for this particular candidate because they want the issues that they care about to be addressed once the politician is in office. This meant that the action of voting was dictated by something external to the person, incentives. Other social science theorists would tell us that this is not the case, or not everything can be explained by this. The implication of this explanation by rational choice theory is that political actors, like politicians, leaders, bureaucrats, would do the same thing when in the same situation because they would be given the same incentive structure. In this case, the idea of individual choice and active agency is eliminated. Individual ideas or context of action should be considered rather than just a simplistic notion of self-interest or incentive. Context is important. For example, why did people who voted for Noynoy Aquino in 2010 also voted for Duterte in 2016? What changed regarding their interests? So next is rational choice's bias against government intervention. As it came from economic theory, it follows that rational choice theory is also against government intervention because of the laissez-faire principle. This makes it susceptible to be a self-fulfilling prophecy because there are indeed instances of successful government intervention. Furthermore, there are cases wherein being taught about rational choice made people more rational and self-interested in their choices. Hinmore says, rational choice risks becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy in which teaching students that everyone is self-interested and that government intervention is driven by considerations of electoral interest rather than the public interest encourages people to act in self-interested ways, which increases the chances of government failure. Okay, so do you have this change in mind also that people are self-interested? In that case, maybe this idea, this critique to rational choice theory is true, that when you know that people are self-interested, they may feel that you should be self-interested too. So that's a critique to rational choice theory. So lastly, it's very pessimistic about humans, as you can see. There are real instances when people genuinely want to work for the common good. Another is that it deals poorly with processes of change, as it theorizes based on the status quo and assumes that this will not change. Thank you very much for listening. So look for the activity that is in our VLE for this section. So try to look for the main ideas in this recorded lecture and in your readings, and try to debate on whether it is true that people are self-interested based on a specific scenario. You cite the scenario or issue, or people are not self-interested and rational choice theory is wrong in some ways. Okay, so thank you. So final note, if I have not emphasized this enough, that RCT and other approaches discussed in the class, and probably the approaches that will be discussed in future classes, are a menu of choices that a political scientist can choose from in understanding political phenomena. You can use a single approach or mix different approaches in your studies in the future. Theories are ways of understanding the political world through its concepts, but a single theory cannot explain everything in the world. Thank you.